नमस्ते, मैं सर त्रिवेणी खुराना, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, फैकल्टी फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स, जेवीएन, राजस्थान। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट कॉमन पेरोनियल नर्व पैल्सी। द कॉमन पेरोनियल नर्व इज अ स्मॉलर एंड टर्मिनल ब्रांच ऑफ द शियाटिक नर्व विच इज कम्पोज ऑफ पोस्टीरियर डिविजन ऑफ L4, 5, S1 एंड S2। इट कोर्सेज अलोंग the upper lateral side of the popliteal fossa deep to the biceps femoris and its tendon until it gets to the posterior part of the head of the fibula. It passes forward around the neck of the fibula within the substance of peroneus longus, where it terminates by dividing into superficial and deep fibula, that is peroneal nerves. The nerve can be palpated behind the head of fibula and as it winds around the neck of the fibula. The common peroneal nerve gives articular branches to the knee and superior tibiofibular joint. The lateral uterus nerve of the calf supplies the posterior lateral side of proximal two-thirds of the leg. It usually arises in common with the fibular communicating branch, which joins the sural nerve in the middle third of the leg. While it still lies in the popliteal fossa, the common peroneal nerve gives off the genicular branch to the knee, lateral cutaneous nerve of the calf, sural communicating branch, and the two terminal branches include superficial peroneal nerve and deep peroneal nerve. Superficial branch runs in and supplies the muscles of the lateral compartment of leg. In addition, it supplies the skin over the lateral lower two-third of the leg and the whole of the dorsum of the foot except for the area between the first and second toes, which is supplied by the deep peroneal nerve. Deep branch runs with the anterior tibial vessel over the interosseous membrane into the anterior compartment of the leg and then over the ankle to the dorsum of the foot. It supplies all the muscles of the anterior compartment as well as providing a cutaneous supply to the area between. Motor functions of common peroneal nerve: it innervates short head of biceps femoris directly, also supplies the muscles in the lateral and anterior compartment of leg. Sensory involvement: innervates the skin over the upper lateral and lower posterior lateral leg, also supplies cutaneous innervation to the skin of the anterior lateral leg and the dorsum of foot. Now the assessment by the common peroneal tension test. A common peroneal nerve stress test or slump test while passing the foot and ankle in plantarflexion inversion revealed reproduction of patient symptom. The symptom met the three criteria for positive neural tension. These are side-to-side difference, reproduction of patient symptoms, and changes with a distant component. The peroneal nerve tension test, which is a variation of SLR with the ankle is plantarflexed and inverted at the point of first resistance, may reproduce symptoms. The tenal sign, which is the palpation or tapping of the nerve around the fibular head, may also reproduce symptoms. Heel walking, which serves as a quick growth screen of the peroneal nerve, which is the dorsiflexor for L4 and L5. Toe walking, which serves as a quick growth screen for tibial nerve for S1, S2 involvement and the superficial peroneal nerve for the involvement of S5, S1 and L5. Manual muscle testing may further reveal weakness of peroneus longus, peroneus brevis, peroneus tertius, tibialis anterior, extensor digitorum longus brevis, extensor hallucis longus and brevis. During gait analysis, the physical therapist may notice foot drop, slapping gait or toe drag during swing phase. The common peroneal nerve is in partially vulnerable position as it winds around the neck of the fibula. It may be damaged at the site by trauma or injury to knee, TKA, compression of the fibula head during surgery, example tourniquet, fracture to the fibula, fracture to tibial plateau, use of tight plaster cast of lower leg, crossing the legs regularly, pressure to the knee from positions during sleep or coma, patellar dislocations, which may contribute 33% chances of nerve damage. Common peroneal nerve injury is often seen in people who are very thin, predisposed to autoimmune conditions such as RA, nerve damage secondary to chronic health issues, for example diabetes, alcoholism, charcot marie tooth, have a significant knee valgus or varus. Damage to this nerve is followed by foot drop, which is due to paralysis of ankle and foot extensors. And inversion of the foot due to paralysis of peroneal muscles with unsupposed action of the foot flexors and inverters. There is also anesthesia over the anterior and later spread to the leg and foot. Although the major side escape is, since this is innervated by saphenous branch of the femoral nerve. Neuropathic pain can also be a common symptom to peroneal nerve neuropathy, which can be managed with analgesia. Peroneal nerve compromise has been reported due to numerous traumatic and insidious causes. Traumatic causes of nerve injury occur in associated musculoskeletal injury or with isolated nerve traction, compression or laceration. Insidious causes include mass lesion and metabolic syndrome. The common peroneal nerve may be threatened by the tendinous origin of peroneus longus. This is more susceptible to injury at knee. However, sciatic and peroneal nerve may be compromised at hip and ankle as well. At the hip, the lateral fibers of sciatic nerve are most susceptible to injury. These are the fibers that will form the common peroneal nerve at the knee. The lateral location of the nerve fibers threading at the fibular head and the larger size of funiculi are likely to be responsible for their susceptibility. Acetabular fracture, femur fracture, operative repair of these fractures jeopardize these nerve fibers. The most commonly reported complication of hip osteotomy is sciatic nerve paresis. This injury has been reported with posterior hip dislocation without fracture. The common peroneal nerve may be injured at the knee with a fracture of the fibula or tibia, especially at the proximal fibula. There is an approximation 1% incidence of peroneal nerve injury with tibial fracture. Peroneal nerve injury after ankle sprain was first described by Hislop in 1941 in a case series of 3 patients. The mechanism of injury was proposed as a traction injury of the nerve in posterior lateral knee from a sudden force with the patient's foot in plantar flexion and inversion. If there has been an injury to peroneal nerve at the knee during lateral ankle sprain, this could be detected within 2 weeks after injury on electromyographic examination. Iatrogenic injury of peroneal nerve can occur from direct manipulation during lateral hip and leg rotation with knee flexion, as occur in the operating position for orthopedic surgeries. This position is often used in gynecologic as well as abdominal surgeries. In addition to positioning during surgery, patients who require prolonged bed rest after surgery may be at risk for peroneal neuropathy. Gravity, the shape of the lower extremity, and muscular imbalance contribute to the tendency of the lower limb to resist in external rotation of hip and flexion while lying supine. This position, together with the bony prominence, the fibular head, may jeopardize the peroneal nerve unless a preventive program is instituted. Less commonly, peroneal nerve injury occurs as a result of laceration. Evaluation. Initially, patient with peroneal neuropathy complained of lateral lower limb and dorsal foot pain. Concurrent low back pain or posterior lateral thigh pain suggest L5 radiculopathy. Pain usually precedes sensory changes in a similar distribution. Patient may complain of foot drop as the first manifestation of this disorder. Patient's leg should be examined for ecchymosis, edema, ulcer, evidence of trauma or vascular compromise may help to determine the cause of the lesion. The peroneal nerve may be palpated as it winds around the head of fibula. Tapping over this area may reproduce dysesthesia in the lateral calf or foot. Careful sensory examination can assist with localizing the lesion. The deep peroneal nerve supplies the area between the first and the second toes. The remaining dorsum of the foot is innervated by the superficial peroneal nerve except for a small area laterally. Sensation of the plantar foot is paired in lesions of the peroneal nerve. All muscles of the lower limb should be examined for weakness and compared to the contralateral side. Weakness of the ankle dorsiflexors, toe extensors and ankle inverters, commonly referred to as foot drop, which is suggestive of peroneal neuropathy. In a series of 303 patients with foot drop, 31% of these lesions were due to peroneal neuropathy. Often patients with L5 radiculopathy have similar deficits as those with the common peroneal neuropathy. The tibialis posterior, which is innervated by tibial nerve, receives its segmental innervation from L5. This muscle provides the majority of ankle inversion. If ankle inversion is weak, the lesion involves more than the common peroneal nerve. Examination of normal and pathologic reflex can further narrow the differentiation. The patellar tendon reflex is innervated by L2 through L4 nerve roots. The Achilles reflex is primarily from S1. Absent or diminished reflexes suggest a peripheral origin of foot drop. The presence of pathological reflex such as Babinski suggests foot drop of central origin. Imaging and electrodiagnostics such as radiographs, MRI is used to evaluate, and electrodiagnostic studies assist with the confirming the diagnosis of peroneal neuropathy, excluding alternative diagnosis and determining prognosis. Recommended examinations include motor nerve conduction studies of peroneal nerve and tibial nerve, and sensory nerve conduction studies of subcerebral and superficial peroneal nerves. In general, if the lesion involves demyelination, focal slowing or conduction block can be seen. If the lesion is due to axonal loss, compound muscle action potential amplitudes decreased at all stimulation sites. Natal electromyography exam can further localize the lesion. Routine muscle examining for this study include two muscles innervated by deep peroneal nerve and one muscle which is innervated by supraperoneal nerve, tibialis posterior, another muscle innervated by tibial nerve, that is medial gastrocnemius, and the short head of biceps femoris. If any of the muscles supplied by peroneal nerve are abnormal, further muscles supplied by L4 nerve root but not the peroneal nerve, that is tibialis posterior, should be evaluated to exclude radiculopathy, lumbosacral plexopathy, and sciatic neuropathy. Now the treatment. Earlier symptom in peroneal neuropathy may be most difficult to treat. Currently available agents for neuropathic pain include topical lidocaine, capsaicin, selective serotonin, reuptake inhibitors, anti-epileptics, opioids. As these provide symptomatic relief only, the choice of medication depends on comorbidities and possible adverse effects. Modalities such as heat and ice can also provide effective pain relief. However, patients with sensory loss should be carefully observed during the use of modalities to prevent skin damage. Also, superficial ice treatment may injure the peroneal nerve at the fibular head when applied incorrectly. This was reported in the case of a football player who applied ice to a hamstring muscle strain. Skin damage from the superficial cold application does not usually occur with the use of protective barrier for the skin and limited duration of therapy. Superficial heat may result in brain injury. This can occur with lying on heat pad or prolonged therapy. Antiporosis has been suggested for the relief of pain in peroneal neuropathy. This involves the transcutaneous delivery of the ionic medication into soft tissue with the use of electrical current. Weakness in peroneal neuropathy may lead to functional gait impairment. Muscle atrophy can become clinically apparent at 2 weeks after injury. If there is transection of nerve or a complete axon loss lesion, it will be no use to attempt to strengthen the denervative muscles. If there is a compression, it is best to relieve the offending agent prior to a trial of strengthening. If patient has septal peroneology, strengthening may help with the functional recovery. If patient has complete loss of strength, passive radio motion may be all that is possible. It is imperative to maintain proper ankle range of motion so that residual heel cord contracture will not preclude the ability to walk. Thank you.